Bro, tell me we still know of how to speak of kings. In the old days, everyone knew what men were. Brave, bold, glory-bound. Only stories now. But I'll sound the Spear Dane song, hoarded for hungry times. Their first father was a foundling, skilled skeffing. He spent his youth, fists up, brow-beating every bastard brother, bonfiring his enemies. That man began in the waves, a baby in a basket, but he bootstrapped his way into a kingdom, trading loneliness for luxury. Whether they thought kneeling necessary or no, everyone from head to tail of the whale road bent down. There's a king, there's his crown. That was a good king. Later, God sent Skild a son, a wolf cub, further proof of manhood. Being God, he knew how the Spear Danes had suffered, the misery they'd mangled through, leaderless, long years of loss. So the Life Lord, that almighty big boss, birthed them an earthshaker. Beowulf's name kissed legions of lips. By the time he was half grown, but his own father was still breathing. We all know a boy can't daddy until his daddy's dead. A smart son gives gifts to his father's friends in peacetime. When war woos him, as war will, he'll need those troops to follow the leader. Privilege is the way men prime power the world over. Skild was iron until the end. When he died, his warriors executed his final orders. They swaddled their king of rings and did just as the Dane had demanded, back when mind and meter could merge in his mouth. They bore him to the harbour, and into the bosom of a ship, that father they'd followed, that man they'd adored. She was anchored and eager to embark, an ice maiden built to bear the weight of a prince. They laid him by the mast, packed tight in his treasure trove, bright swords, war weeds, his lap holding a hoard of flood tithes, each fair coin placed by a loyal man. He who pays the piper calls the tune. His shroud shone, ringed in runes, sun-stitched. I've never heard of any ship so heavy, nor corpse so rich. Skild came into the world unfavoured. His men waited him as well as the strangers had, who'd once warped him to the waves weft. Even ghosts must be fitted to fight. The warband flew a golden flag over their main man. The salt sea saluted him, so too the storms. And skilled soldiers got drunk instead of crying. They mourned the way men do. No man knows, not me, not you, who hauled Skild's hordes to shore, but the poor are plentiful, and somebody got lucky. Finally, Beowulf rolled into righteous rule, daddying for decades after his own daddy died. At first, though, it was his turn for erasure. His son, the Half-Dane, run roughshod, smothering his father's story with his own. He rose in the realm and became a famous warlord, fighting ferociously, dawn to dusk, fathering his own horde of four heirs, marching into the world. In this order, Hjorgar, Hrothgar, Halga, and, I heard, he hand-clasped his daughter. Her name's a blur, to Onela. Tender, she rendered that battle-swede, happy in fucking, where before he'd only been happy in fighting. War was the wife Hrothgar wed first. Battles won, treasures taken. Admirers and kin heard of his fight fortune and flanked him in force. Strong boys grow into stronger men. And when Hrothgar had an army, his hopes turned to a hall, to home them, a house to espouse his faithful, more than just a mead hall, a world's wonder, eighth of seven. When it was done, he swore he'd load lighten, unhand everything he'd won, worn and owned, pass to his posse all God's gifts, save lives and land. He'd keep the kingdom, of course. He gave far-reaching orders, carpets, carpentry, walls and gables, tables for seating a clan, rare gifts plated like rare meat, all for his men. So it rose, a greater hall than any other. Hrothgar filled it, blood brother, by blood brother, and named it Heorot. His words were heard and heralded, and yes, yes, bro, the man was more than just talk. He gave good gifts. His war wedded war king's rings and drank their leader's mead. Nightly he fated his fight family with fortunes. The hall loomed, golden towers, antler-tipped. It was asking for burning, but that hadn't happened yet. You know how it is. Every castle wants invading, and every family has enemies born within it. Old grudges recrudesce. Speaking of grudges, out there in the dark, one waited. He listened, holding himself hard to home, but he'd been lonely too long, brotherless, sludge-stranded. Now he heard and endured the din of drinkers. Their poetry poisoned his peace. Every night, turmoil, raucous laughter from Heorot, howling of harps, squawking of scops, men recounting the history of men like them. The Almighty made earth for us, they sang, sun and moon for our delight. Fears, fens full of creatures for our feasting, mirrors to quench our thirst. Heorot's hall dwellers caroused by candlelight, stumbling to sleep with the sunrise, replete, lambs bleating, comfort, ease pleased, until the night, wakefulness, moved their watcher to wrath. Grendel was the name of this woe-walker. Unlucky, fucked by fate, he'd been living rough for years, ruling the wild, the mere, the fen and the fastness, his kingdom. His creation was cursed. Under the line of Cain, the kin-killer, the Lord long ago had taken Abel's side, though none of that was Grendel's doing. He'd descended from bloodstains. From Cain had come a cruel kind, seen by some as shadow-stalked, monsters, elves, giants who'd ground against God, and for that been banished. Under a new moon, Grendel set out to see what horde haunted this hall. He found the ringdanes drunk, doused down, making beds of benches. They were mead-medicated, untroubled by pain, their sleep untainted by sorrow. Grendel hurt, and so he hunted. This stranger taught the Danes about time. He struck, seized 30 dreaming men and hied himself home, bludgeoning his burden as he bounded, for the Danes had slept sweetly in a world that had woken him, benefited from bounty, even as they'd broken him. That'll do for now. That's Beowulf, a new translation by Maria Dahvana Headley.